Canada and ABC Audio Studios present The Eleventh, hosted by Alex Mann.
November the 11th, 1975, was one of the most momentous days in Australian political history. But it didn't start out that way.
It was just another day.
A cadet journalist was answering phones at the Parliament House Bureau.
I was sitting in the office in my little corner.
Meanwhile, a comedian known for his political satire was eating lunch in a Sydney Chinese restaurant.
Not in a Chinese restaurant, the best Pekingese restaurant in Sydney at the time.
And a teenager was making an after-school snack.
I remember I'd just taken the toast out of the grill and I was sort of fixing it up with a knife.
What they didn't know was that the day was about to take a dramatic turn. Soon, they would all converge on the steps of Parliament House in Canberra because they were about to hear some big news.
Canberra is the scene of events unprecedented in Australian political history.
The phone rang and I answered it.
Mum was on the phone and just came racing into the room.
And I got a phone call and I had to go up to the desk to take it.
And she said, Gough's been sacked.
Gough Whitlam has just been sacked.
You really need to get downstairs onto the steps. You've got about 10 minutes.
The Prime Minister, Mr. Whitlam, was today sacked.
And I think I probably had to have that explained to me, what that meant.
Basically, we all said, what?
I'm like, I panicked.
You know, we have a democratically elected government and this guy, the Governor General, fires it. I mean, it was unprecedented.
I grabbed my notebook and went running down.
And she said, we're all going to Parliament House to demonstrate. Get in the car.
I got on the plane to Canberra, picked up the crew and went off to Parliament House.
I got there quite quickly. There were a few people starting to gather.
It was just so confusing. It was unbelievable. We ran to the front of Parliament House.
Before she got to the steps of Parliament House, that school student, Susan Menadue, ran into her dad.
He was biting his lower lip when he came and I thought, oh, well, he's really stressed.
Susan's dad was stressed because he'd actually been caught right in the centre of the dramatic events that day. He was the head of the Prime Minister's department, the public servant closest to the centre of political power. His name was John Menadue, and he's actually central to our story. A few hours earlier, he'd been told that his boss, Gough Whitlam, had been sacked.
I thought I'd been working for Gough Whitlam. Now it was clear to me that I wasn't. I was working, in fact, for Malcolm Fraser. And so I didn't know quite what to do.
As he rushed around trying to understand what was happening, he ran into his kids and his wife, Cynthia, near the front of Parliament House.
And I said, where are you going? And Cynthia said, we're going over to demonstrate against that bastard Fraser. It was a phrase, term like bastard I'd never heard her use in my life. Then or since.
More than 40 years later, the emotion of that moment is still raw.
But it suddenly dawned on me, it's almost like a bucket of water being thrown over my head, that something quite dramatic had happened. Finally, the gravity of what had happened, the immorality, the deception that I had witnessed now started coming to me.
And an extraordinary scene, the like of which probably hasn't been seen too many times before.
There's an enormous, spontaneous sense of outrage, Bob. You can sense it.
Yeah. There are literally hundreds of members of the general public who have thronged into King's Hall and are spilling out onto the steps of the Parliament as news of what had happened got around.
By now, there were hundreds on the steps and they were chanting.
And then you just hear this big whoosh noise as the big front doors opened and I just turned around and there was Whitlam.
We want Gough! We want Gough!
Ladies and gentlemen. Well may we say, God save the Queen. Because nothing will save the Governor General.
No! could not allow a House Senate election because it would not allow a sufficiently clear prospect of the deadlock being resolved.
It's one of the most extraordinary times ever seen in the national capital, but these news conferences, both Mr. Fraser...
Following the dismissal by Sir John Kerr, the Governor-General of...
This is probably the most iconic moment in Australian political history, the sacking of Gough Whitlam on the 11th of November 1975. The grainy black and white footage of that moment, when he spoke to the crowd on the steps of Old Parliament House, it's etched into my brain, and I wasn't even born when it happened. But what's missing for me is what's outside the frame of that shot. The unseen players, the scandals, the plots, the abuses of power. I went looking for those missing pieces, and now I want to tell you what I found. Because the incredible part of Whitlam's dismissal isn't what happened on the steps. It's the story of what led up to that moment. And there are parts of that story that no one has heard before.
The ordinary punter in the street had no idea what was going on.
Where can you get a more dramatic, fantastic, unfathomable, incomprehensible and catastrophic story than this?
And I said, would you, in the interest of history, speak to me about it? And he looked at me and said, I owe history nothing.
This is the story of a government that came to radically transform Australia, and in doing so, came completely undone.
If the government wasn't going to play by the rules, well, then they were going to stop the game.
It's a spy thriller, a political drama, and a romance novel.
How could these people be trusted anymore?
I think there are enormous secrets and deceptions at the time of the dismissal.
As one American official referred to it, a bit of spooky fiddling.
Can you believe this shit?
I'm Alex Mann, and over the next 7 episodes, I'll take you inside the highest circles of power and speak with those who were there to uncover the hidden story behind what happened on the 11th. To truly understand the dismissal, you need to understand the story of the transformation Australia went through to get there. You need to go back to a time before Whitlam lost his job, before the gloss came off his government, and before he was even elected. This story starts with a guy called Peter O'Brien, because his story is the story of an Australian political awakening, and it starts when Peter was just a kid.
I always wanted to be a policeman because the policeman I dealt with in the suburb I was brought up in, which is South Melbourne in Victoria, we had a police force down there which was very community orientated.
Growing up, Peter O'Brien looked up to his local cops.
In those days, if you were perhaps using a shanghai in the street and busting a few streetlights, the general result was you got a clip behind the ear from the local copper who took you home to your father who gave you another clip behind the ear. And the matter was settled in that way. But there was always that feeling that that man was there to protect you.
When Peter eventually left school, he signed up at the police academy to become a cop himself. His belief in enforcing the law only got stronger.
The only alternative to law and its enforcement is anarchy. And in anarchy, the weak go down, only the strong survive. So therefore, it became a moral crusade as well as a personal one.
In many ways, Peter's outlook was pretty typical of most Australians. He'd grown up in a conservative time when things seemed simple and it felt easy to identify who the bad guys were. But for Peter and the rest of the country, things were about to get a whole lot more complicated.
What do you feel about going out on a patrol like this?
Don't really know yet. First time I've experienced it.
Australia's commitment of nearly 2,000 more men to Vietnam is announced in Parliament today by the Prime Minister.
How long have you been in Vietnam?
For 2 weeks.
To many people in the 60s, the ultimate bad guys were the communists. And the concern was that if Southeast Asia went communist, the Australian continent would soon be threatened. So initially, there was widespread support for the nation's commitment to the Vietnam War. But as Australia's war effort ramped up, confronting images from the front line started beaming straight into people's lounge rooms.
You don't feel a bit scared?
Oh, a bit, you know.
How do you feel about the fact that you're up here in Vietnam now?
Oh, well, I'd prefer to be at home. I hope they abolish national service.
Back then, national service was decided by a brutal and devastatingly random ballot. For that young copper, Peter O'Brien, and for the rest of the country, it would soon become a catalyst for radical social change.
It was later in 68 that I attended the first ballot, the ball drawing, at 125 Swanson Street in Melbourne, the headquarters of the Department of Labour and National Service.
Peter O'Brien was there as an undercover cop to monitor the ballot. He watched as dozens of small marbles rattled around in the barrel, each one carrying a small number and the destiny of young men all around Australia.
Numbered marbles representing all of the birth dates applicable to the men covered by this ballot would be placed in the barrel.
An official would reach into the barrel and pluck out a marble and then read out the number.
230, 213.
And if the numbers matched the day you were born...
30, August 17, February 17, correct.
You were going to war. And if you said no, you went to prison instead. This process of randomly forcing young men off to war was becoming pretty controversial. That's why Peter O'Brien was there at the ballot draw that day, to make sure that the ballot went smoothly. So when a group of protesters rocked up, Peter wasn't happy.
I was horrified to see these people, this group of people, not a large group, there would have been only perhaps 40 or 50 involved in it. There was still a general acceptance in the community of Australia's involvement in Vietnam. And this demonstration, I looked at it and I thought, who are these bunch of idiots? What right have they got to question the supremacy of the law? Are these people insurgents, perhaps? Are they being paid by the Communist Party to stir up actions against the government? All of these thoughts cross your mind.
That day, Peter couldn't understand why people were protesting against the war, but soon he would make an arrest that would leave him questioning everything. The man he arrested was a young high school teacher whose birthday had come up in the ballot.
This was a teacher, a simple, straightforward, ordinary teacher that you would find probably in the majority of our high schools.
The teacher had refused to go to war. He was a draft resistor.
We went into the high school and we arrested him in the front of his students.
Peter O'Brien had to cuff him and take him to one of the most notorious prisons in Australia.
I'd been in and out of the place many, many times. I felt nothing, you know. I took prisoners in, took prisoners out, felt nothing. But in this day, I felt that I was taking an innocent man into prison. There was almost a look of despair on his face, perhaps saying to himself, why have I done this to myself, you know? But I'd like him to know that I felt that despair too. That it was at that point that I said to myself, my God, what have I done?
But Peter O'Brien was still a cop. He had responsibilities and he still had this strong sense of duty. He decided to squash those feelings and get on with his job.
You rationalise. You say to yourself, the law is supreme, so therefore they must be wrong. I must be right.
But the voices arguing against those laws were getting louder, and Peter O'Brien was finding it harder to ignore them. There was one guy especially that he just kept hearing about, the most prominent leader of the anti-war movement, a Labor MP called Jim Cairns.
I have always said if I were 20 years old and required to go into the army under conscription in relation to a war like Vietnam, I would not go. I have also said this is a very significant decision for any young man to take, and I leave it to him to take it. But I say quite clearly, if I were facing that situation, I would not go. I would not be in it.
Jim Cairns was someone who brought people with him, someone who changed the way that people thought about the war. Or so I'm told, because to me, he seems a bit like a cross between a worldly orator with grand convictions.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.